Monday. It's the 3rd of April. You know, goes over the weekend, I was looking at some of the feedback, and boy, they just want the show to get started. They don't even like they don't even appreciate this pre-show at all. Really? Kind of pissed me off, yeah. So it's just a pre-show. Calm down. You know, we could turn on the cameras in about 3 or 4 minutes, and that's that. But we're kind of getting you all warmed up. So I'm George, the host. This is Goes, our devious and dastardly co-host, and this is Jason Janae, who will be from Ingrain Media, who will be co-hosting with us for parts of the show. We have a lot of guests coming your way. It's a short week, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and then we have Thursday and Friday off as we head back east on a morale visit to a couple of different bases, Langley Air Base and Fort Eustis, together known as JBLE, Joint Base Langley Eustis. We went there in December, and they've asked us to come back, and we're excited.
Yeah, it's going to be a fun trip. We're going to be going, it'll be myself, George, Stitch Duran was just added over the weekend. He's been on every trip we've been on, and we were able to work it out so that he could come on this one. And then fighter-wise, we're going to have Todd Duffy, Felice Herrig, Kevin Lee, and Brad Tavares will all be going with us.
Yeah, it's going to be a fun trip. And again, we leave on Wednesday, but after the show on Wednesday, so a lot of guests headed your way. Today we'll be talking to King Mo, Iaquinta, Patrick Cote, and Daniel Weichel. And anytime we have an opportunity, we'll pick this man's brain because he's been involved in the sport for a long time as an MMA manager. And in talking to him, man, he's an analytics, did I say that right? Advertising, marketing guru. So it should be a fun show. And I know you all are going to have a good time. Of course, you can call in and participate at any time. 866-522-2846. In fact, do it now. Get in the queue because once we get going, if these lines don't fill up, then it's just us two. We're going to chat about Bellator 175, which took place on Friday, and we'll talk about UFC 210, which is coming up this Saturday. Of course, all those other shows that accompany the sport, like Cage Warriors had their 82nd edition. There was a CES show, and there's stuff coming up this week as well. So it's going to be a fun time here. 866-522-2846. You call in, we'll give you some time, and we can talk about whatever you want. Also, congratulations to the University of North Carolina and Gonzaga University. They will meet in tonight's final, and that'll be the end. No more March Madness talk for another year. But it's been quite a fun month because there's really those tournaments, conference tournaments, and then 3 weeks of March Madness, so it's crazy.
My stun gun story revolves around March Madness and Gonzaga. Yeah.
What's that? You're not happy for them?
I'm happy for them.
Okay.
But I'm not happy for an individual who's trying to claim them.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah. I can't wait to hear this one. Jason, do you give a shit about March Madness? Or are you more MMA? Or what are you all about?
I don't watch a lot of sports. But no. I do like Gonzaga. I kind of like that underdog story.
Yeah.
They've always kind of been on the cusp, not supposed to be there.
And here they are.
I can appreciate the big business. You know, they're up against a huge funded school.
Right. A powerhouse, a traditional NC2A basketball powerhouse.
If you're a great high school basketball player, you would rather go to North Carolina versus Gonzaga, but here they are.
All right, here we go.
All right, guys.
We're
going
to start the show.
Do they stop being an underdog at some point? They're always in the finals.
Victoria, we can't hear anything. You want to tell her that?
We just did.
There's no escape. No escape. Through the vast frontier of cyberspace and through a sea of stars in outer space.
One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
We've solidified our combat communication stranglehold.
We are controlling transmission.
With the use of MMA Junkie Radio and SiriusXM satellite radio technology. MMA Junkie Radio. Commence transmission. Live From MMA Junkie Radio HQ in the fight capital of the world, Las Vegas, Nevada, here are your hosts, Gorgeous George and Go.
From the fight capital of the world inside the beautiful Mandalay Bay Racing Sportsbook, you are listening to the MMA Junkie Radio Show. It's Monday, April 3rd, and we are live here in Sin City. That's Goes to my left. I'm George, the host. Back east, handling all the producing duties, it's Victoria. And sitting to my right is Jason Janae from Ingrain Media, MMA manager extraordinaire. What's up, guys? How you doing, Jason? Welcome.
Thanks for having me.
Excited. It's Monday. There's a lot going on.
Yeah. There was a Bellator on Friday. There was a March Madness Final Four on Saturday. Mm-hmm. And WrestleMania on Sunday. So you're right. Lots going on.
And?
Not to mention the fact that there was. Goes, take it from there.
Oh, from there I will take it. Today's opening day, baseball.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That's what
Can't wait to get that underway. And
well, I thought yesterday was.
That's kind of like
a soft opening.
A little preview, yeah.
Where they invite just the employees and friends, but it's not the public.
But the highlights of today, these are the focus teams.
Okay.
Today the fans can fight.
Gotcha.
That's true.
There was no fighting yesterday.
Nothing? No. Well, yeah, Dodger Stadium.
Then, the card, man, I'm starting to get those little jitters that come with being an MMA fan. Mm-hmm. UFC 210 is upon us.
Dude, I got that damn Proteus. He texted me Friday night, Saturday night. He goes, is DC hurt? Is it off? And I go, fucking A, here we go, man. I had to pull over, and I go, where'd you hear this? What's the source? You know, because right away I skimmed Twitter, and I didn't see it. And then he, 5 minutes later, says, it turns out to be it's – and I don't think it was April 1st, so I don't even think it was that. It was just someone being a jag-off.
Oh, April 1st is getting out of control
and,
now, right?
But it did scare me. But I knew, I was aware that it was not April Fool's at that time, but the fact that it's, I guess someone could turn it into an April Fool's weekend, I don't know. So, yeah, that
if
sucked for
a moment. If you're a business out there and you've got bad news, put it out on April 1st. No one's going to believe it, so they'll be like, oh, I'm not sure
that's the day.
Actually bad
day.
News.
Yeah. Today's the day. We're having layoffs. You know. But anyway, so lots to talk about. It's Stun Gun Monday as well. So if you have a Stun Gun story, you can share it with us. Goes is chomping at the bit. He's got one. We'll get to that. Goes, this is an MMA show, though. Let's start off with Bellator 175, Rampage Jackson versus King Mo. Your thoughts on that fight? King Mo won the fight, and he will now face Ryan Bader at Bellator NYC, which is the same as Bellator 180.
It felt like I was watching Pride because I could not believe how much bigger Rampage was than King Mo. And in order for him to get the victory that night, he had to fight a certain style of fight. And that fight's probably not going to be appealing to the general public.
Especially coming off a fight where he fought a bigger man in Crow Cup. Mm-hmm. And same thing. There was a recipe that was working. And then all of a sudden, the bigger man was able to take out King Mo, so I'm sure there was some of that sitting behind.
Even more now, because when he did open up in that fight is when he got caught by Crow Cop. So I think this time he had to be really disciplined, although he did let his hands go a little bit more than I think he did in the first fight. Mm-hmm. It was a fun fight for me. Round one was pretty easy. Round two, other way. Round three, King Mo. I don't think anybody was really doubting the decision or anything. There wasn't much controversy.
No, it was clear 2-1.
This is the last time that I would like to see King Mo fight a heavyweight. It's just too much size for him. It really is. Props to him. You're the man for doing it, but I don't really have too much of an interest in seeing him do that. I'm glad that now he's back to where he needs to be. Some people even say 185 is where he needs to be, but 205, Ryan Bader. The only thing that scares me is this is a lot. You know, a lot for his body, a lot of training camps. A lot of fights, mentally, physically, it's rough. And this is no gift by any means.
Hell
right?
No,
Ryan Bader, this
Bader's
is a tough
legit.
Guy.
You
I wish
to
he would have taken
Bader.
Some yep. time off.
There's two legit wrestlers, tacticians in the wrestling room, for sure. So, I mean, and if you watch any NCAA finals, those can be some of the most exciting matches or the boringest matches if they really kind of can counter each other. And it could go that way. It could be very similar to a heavyweight matchup with him where he's just having to be cautious because he's in there with someone simply equal on the grappling side.
You nailed it, Goz. It wasn't a fun fight. You know, nobody walked away feeling like it's up for fight of the year or anything. It was a tactical fight. And I think you backed it up with plenty of facts about how King Mo had to approach this. You know, when he lost to Crow Cop, a lot of people forget he fought 2 days before because it was a tournament. Then he fought Crow Cop. But even 1 week before that, he fought Satoshi Ishii in Ireland. So think about that travel. Florida to Ireland, back to Florida, and then to Japan, fighting these bigger men. And, yeah, I would say the same thing. And we get a chance to tell them, in about 10 minutes when we have King Mo on as our first guest of today. Hey, man, we're good with the heavyweight. You proved yourself. You're tough. You can beat heavyweights. We get it. But just no more of that. Chase after belts.
Yeah, I would say we give him the money weight championship and just say that's the end of that, right?
Right, yeah. I just don't know what else there is to see because really, if there's some glory in it, then you know what? You might as well start saying, Bellator, what are you doing with this belt? And let's fight for the title and get it done. But these fun fights, money fights, no, I think there's more money when you're a world champion. I'll still stand by that. I know Nate Diaz would disagree, but trust me, if Nate Diaz had beaten Conor McGregor the second time, and then he was the one that took out Rafael Dos Anjos prior to Alvarez, guess what? He'd be the champion. He'd have the two wins over Conor, and he'd have a lot more money than he does now. So I think the belt it should always be what fighters strive for.
I'm kind of curious what Bellator's thinking behind the scenes when they put this together, because this is a very scary matchup for Ryan Bader as well. King Mo's no slouch, okay? And we've seen what happened the first when they brought over Benson Henderson. That didn't go over too well.
Right.
And so I thought they had kind of learned a lesson there, but you're giving Ryan Bader a very tough competitor in King Mo when really what you want more than likely is for Ryan Bader to be that guy to come in. We thought he was going to face Phil Davis.
And they both agreed. So what happened? What fell apart? I'd like to know.
I guess we'd have to find out. All I keep hearing is, well, that's what the fighters want. But, I mean, yeah, the fighters don't always get their ways, though, in MMA, so there's got to be some.
Lorenz Larkin got an immediate shot. Benson didn't. So yeah, you're right. There's a little inconsistency on what they want to do. Benson did get his immediate shot in a division that he had fought in, but it wasn't his division. The lightweight division was his division.
Work it the other way though, because we architect Ben's career. I remember sitting at Payway Diner in Mesa, Arizona, with him, and at that time he was sparring partners with Varner, so he was just really wanting to know. He felt like he was on that level. Like, how do I get that Varner style?
Right.
Right? He's like, I need to be in the UFC. That's where everyone needs to be. And I remember looking at him and his coach, John, and I'm like, look, let's go win the WEC belt. Win the WEC belt. Then you're going to skip 10 to 15 beasts at the 155 UFC lightweight division, because just making your way to that belt, you're going through the who's who of grinders, right? So you can bunny hop them if you can win this easier belt, quote-unquote easier belt, right? So it was a better career trajectory. He went into the UFC. He did bunny hop those people, and he went and went on and got a title. On his way to Bellator, he was on the downside of that. So for Coker to give him an immediate title shot, but being number 15 in the world at that time, it may not be indicative of his skill set, but when you start losing a few fights, you slide down that rankings, and it's hard to give number 15 in the number 2 division promotion in the world a title shot right away.
Right. You know, well, that's why I was confused by the Larkin assignment. You know, they're giving him Lima. But, hey, you know what? You got to trust in Scott Coker. So I always say, you know, we'll talk about it, we'll question it, but in the end, there's probably something telling him why he didn't book Bader versus Davis, why he did book Larkin versus Lima, and why he started off with Benson at welterweight. Who knows? Anyway, all right, 866-522-2846. We'll squeeze in a couple calls before we get to King Mo, but once we get to King Mo, there are other guests coming your way. I think I said this on the pre-show. If I'm repeating myself, then I'm getting old. What do you want from me? Iaquinta will also join us, Patrick Cote, Daniel Weichel, and, of course, we've got to take a couple of commercials, so we have to hustle through this. Sergey Karitonov, classic KO over Chase Gormley. I wasn't too sure that he wasn't going to be the one that maybe fell to two losses in a row, mm-hmm. because Javi Ayala took him out late last year, but he caught Gormley, man. It was a walk-off KO. It was beautiful.
Great shot, yeah. Mm-hmm. Hey, I want to go back to Mo really quick. The other thing, and I think, Jason, you brought this up earlier, was I want to know what Bellator's thinking was with the matchup in particular, because it sounded like it was already all planned out, but what if King Mo would have lost the fight to Rampage? Is that one where you just kind of tell everybody at the last second, okay, it's off?
Right.
I mean, that seemed like a kind of a big risk to take. I don't know. How do you feel that went down, George?
I got distracted. I'm going to come
clean. Okay. So when the fight ends,
they
announced the fight.
Right.
But what if Mo had lost that mm-hmm. fight to Rampage? Would that then fight have
maybe
still been on?
Or I don't know. That's a good question.
How did all that come about?
It's a good question. It could be. Because King Mo was well aware. He's like, where Ryan Bader at? Mm-hmm. You're right. If Rampage wins, what happens? I don't think Page drops to 205 to fight Bader. Mm-hmm. And I guess Bader might fight Phil Davis then. Who? I don't even know why Phil Davis is not fighting Ryan Bader still.
I think it's to avoid having a UFC product. So by having him fight Mo, you end up with a fight that Ryan hasn't had yet. Okay. Even though it's a similar style, they might have
because it would be a
met
replay.
Up in high school or college. You know, there could be a backstory there. But the reality is we've already seen Phil and Ryan, and we've seen it in a different promotion that they're trying to be better than. So why not put a different fight together?
That might be right there.
Mo versus Brian is going to – I mean, Ryan is going to be very competitive in my opinion.
And then my last question is that pay-per-view looks a lot different than it did when we left the show here.
Right.
Now are you going to
buy
it?
Because they just added that one, right?
Yeah, where are we at here? People, are you going to buy it now? Because that's a quality matchup.
And by the way, so for some clarity here, thanks to John Morgan who's listening, Bellator 180 will be the prelims. Bellator NYC will be the main card. I don't know. That's what I was skimming real quick when you were talking, but I think I got that. So to avoid confusion, basically it'll be the same night, but, yeah, different parts of the card. This is a pay-per-view, and goes, you nailed it, man. They're starting to give us more fights because I think people wanted a little bit more, and that's a real good one. So I think at some point people are just going to have to pull out that $49.95. Let's take this call from Jersey Mike, then we'll take that first break because we do have to talk to Kimo. 1:20 p.m. Eastern, 10:20 a.m. Pacific. Back to back, and then we'll do Iaquinta as well. He's got a fight coming up. He hasn't fought in 2 years, for crying out loud. He's one of the best 55-fivers out there. I'm glad to see him back in the ballgame. Jersey Mike, what's on your mind, brother?
Not too much. I was thinking that Rampage usually has, in my opinion, a very large head. But I want to know what you guys think, because I thought it looked pretty tiny on the heavyweight body.
Rampage Jackson?
Yeah. I think that he has a pretty big head at 205, but on the heavyweight body, kind of looked like a small head.
I mean, it would stand a reason because now you have an extra 40 pounds, you know.
In
so.
Person, though, he's pretty big.
Yeah.
Same thing like Thick. With Forrest. You look at Forrest on screen, you're like, oh, he's in shape. But when he's walking through, like, the gym, he's this hulking menace.
Right. Yeah.
So I think that they carry their heavier weights a little bit.
He didn't fight bad for 253. Would you say that? I know a lot of people were expecting Rampage to just completely be gas, and he was. He was sucking wind. I understand that. But, I mean, there was times where he shot, and one of his takedowns looked better than one of Mo's who shot from far. This was later in the ballgame. He still had some power. And then a lot of times he was using a lot of his energy to stop Mo from taking him down, and he exhausted Mo's gas tank. Mm-hmm. So, again, Rampage, I'm just going to assume, I mean, look, he says he put in the camp, he did the work, but to me it looked like a guy that maybe didn't, but yet he still fought well. So if he got down from, instead of 253, just give me a rock solid 235, 240, he could probably be the Bellator heavyweight champ.
You know, the
Minnikov's nowhere to be found, so he'd be fighting what? Congo, Lashley, Mitrione, Fedor. I think he might be able to pull it off.
When have we ever seen Rampage go backwards? I'd never seen that before, and he just didn't let his hands go in round one.
Wasn't,
and it just seemed like a guy that didn't want to be there.
That's probably an interesting story.
Thanks, Mike, for the call.
Mitrione versus Rampage at heavyweight, because Rampage basically picked on him during the show, right? I mean, weren't they on the same tough?
Yeah, he was. Meathead was on Rashad's team. Yeah, yeah, there could be something there. Okay, we gotta get this break out of the way. You're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on Sirius XM Rush 93. When we come back, we'll be talking to one of the winners at Bellator 175, King Mo Lawal. We'll see you in a few minutes. Stay close.
I get paid to say things in this cool voice, and they get paid to be lame. Here are Gorgeous George and Goes.
All right, we're back. We're going to be talking to King Mo in a few minutes. What's the update there, Goes? Do we know?
I think Victoria's calling him now.
All right, so we're going to talk to King Mo. He won his fight and then immediately flew to Orlando, Florida to join all the other virgins at WrestleMania 33, which took place last night. And from all accounts, it looked like it was a good time, like they say in the Flintstones, but a good time. The right guys won, a few guys lost, some big names came back, some big names lost, The Undertaker might be done, Goldberg looked better than he did. I read all that stuff. You know, part of me kind of like wishes I would have watched it, to be honest, because growing up I was a pro wrestling fan, but it really is hard to be a hardcore MMA fan and then follow the Lakers, the Trojans, the 49ers, Manchester United, and still have time for pro wrestling. It doesn't add up. There's only 24 hours in a day. So I asked Ghost. I gave him the opportunity to go, do you want to watch WrestleMania? I was hoping he'd go, let's do it. And we'd high five. He didn't want to do it. So I go, all right. And I didn't watch it, but seemed like some pretty decent stuff happened. You know who I really like, Ghost? Is that Shane McMahon guy. So he always takes a big bump in these things. So I started reading that. I was like, God damn it. Why didn't we just get it? It was 3 months. Or 3 pay-per-views for free. They were trying to reel people back in, so we should have done it.
I mean, I'm not sweating it too much.
No?
Nah.
All right. Well, joining us now on the show is the winner of the main event at Bellator 175, top money weight fighter in the world, King Mo. What's up, King Mo? How you doing?
I'm good, man. Just waiting for Billy Gunn to show up because I'm going to meet him. Before I head out.
Is that one of the Road Dogs? Or what's it called? The Road?
New Age Outlaws.
New Age Outlaws? Oh, no, yep. Sorry. His partner was Road Dog, right?
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah.
See, every once in a while I have to refresh my memory, but if I'm not mistaken, they wanted people that weren't fans of them to suck it, right?
Pretty much.
Yeah, okay. Did you have a good time out there at Pro Wrestling or WrestleMania?
Well, it turns out WrestleMania was cool. The Ring of Honor show was great. After WrestleMania, I went to this show called Wrestle Circus, right? That was where it was at. I was there till like 4 in the morning. From 1 to 4:30. Just good hardcore, you know, wrestling, like nonstop, you know, high science action.
Who'd you hang out with?
I was there with my boy, Twan, you know what I'm saying? He's a 13-time Hacky Sack World Champion. You know, he's my boy, you know what I'm saying? He came down with me. We watched the wrestling. That's my dog, man.
Right. But what pro wrestlers were you hanging out with?
I just pretty much.
No love for Hacky Sack World Champion.
Moved around, talked to him.
I mean, come on.
Yeah, no offense to that guy, but yeah, because I ran into Mo once in California, and he was amongst 30 wrestlers there. I remember the Nasty Boys were there, and X-Pac. Yeah. And so Mo was actually talking to these guys.
He met Barry Windham, Marty Jannetty. There were a lot of them.
Yeah.
Follow him on Instagram.
Yeah. I thought he was in that environment. So, yeah, no disrespect to your boy. That's what I thought you meant was you were hanging out with some of these wrestlers too.
No. I ran into some like Moose, Brian Cage, Scorpio Sky, Willie Mack. They was all there, you know what I'm saying, wrestling. So I was chopping up with them a little bit, but they was wrestling. So I was pretty much just watching. Mm-hmm.
You've done this before, though, King Mo. You've done wrestling yourself. Did that bug kind of get you again, or has that ship sailed?
It did, so I saw him taking more bumps. And I was like, man, like, this is exciting. But then I saw him, like, jumping over the top rope. You know what I'm saying? Like, doing, like, suicide stuff. And I was like, man, you know what? Nah, I miss it, but don't miss it all that much.
Is there anything else other than wrestling where you can kind of be that guy and be a little starstruck when you meet these guys? Maybe like pro boxing when you meet some of those boxers?
Yeah. When I meet some pro boxers. Like when I met Larry Holmes, I was shook. When I met James Toney, I was starstruck. You know, there's quite a few. When I met Reagan Dana, I was starstruck. It's just, you know, David, the American Dream, David Reed. There's a lot of them, you know, Tarver, you know, the list goes on. Cause I respect what they do.
That event that I told you about in California, he was starstruck.
Yeah?
Yeah, I was with Mo. He told me to come hang out. I caught up with him. Mo, I remember your reaction, man, when you were talking to Ric Flair. You were like, hell yeah. So I have seen your starstruck face. It was Ric Flair, and then those hopefully I got it right, but I think it was the Nasty Boys. They were pretty cool. It was just a really, really cool environment to see Mo in. But, yeah, I remember Flair was the epitome for both of us.
Oh, you got to meet him, too?
Yeah.
Yeah.
How'd that go?
He was nice. He was real cool. And so as I walked up, Mo goes, "These are my boys." And I walked in with Woody, who's kind of tall. And I remember Ric Flair goes, "Oh, those are the MMA guys." So for one brief moment, he thought I was one of the MMA guys. So I kind of like swelled up a little bit thinking, yeah, I'm with Mo here, you know. We got a problem here anyway, you know. But no, he was real cool. He was just hanging out. You could just tell he was a boss, kind of in control of that conversation.
You know, sometimes you do things where you don't realize you do them. With Ric Flair, I think the first thing I would do without realizing it is probably hide my watch or any jewelry. Because I know I wouldn't be able to compete with that guy.
Yeah. That was years ago, Mo. Do you remember he had just gone through a surgery? He wasn't really open to pictures or anything. Do you remember about that? Is that something we can talk about? Or
I know he had surgery. I forgot what it was, but I know he had surgery because he really wasn't taking many pictures at all.
Yeah, it was kind of regret of mine.
I got like one or two with
them. Oh, did you really?
Yeah.
I think it was something about the environment or something was wrong because somebody had said that, and then we just didn't wind up circling back. He may have headed to his room. Was Roddy Piper still alive at that time? Was he there at that event too, Kingmo?
Yeah, he was there too. As a matter of fact, after I did my run-in to save Bushwhacker Luke, you know, for the show, because he was there before the show, but he came and brought me in the back, and he's like, "Hey, man, what you did was cool, because I did the Bushwhacker dance, but he's like, but at the same time, you're not a legit wrestler, so." He kind of scolded me a little bit because they put me over, and he's like, you know, they shouldn't put me over because I'm not a wrestler. They should put real wrestlers over. So I was like, all right. Well, I was like, hey, I was cool just being like a beat up doll. I didn't care about doing the run in to save nobody. You know, so I was just happy to be here.
Yeah.
And then he understood me, and like we kind of shook my hand. And I was like, you know, I said sorry about it, and I just left.
This was Roddy that did that?
Yeah, man. Oh, wow. Yeah. Kind of.
Okay, yeah. Mo, the next time we're in person, tell me, George, your Roddy Piper story, and then I'll tell you a cool one, too, that honestly can't share. but I also received a little bit of a scolding. Anyway, Bellator 175 took place. Your old buddy, Rampage Jackson, was your opponent. Talk about how good it felt to get your name called. I know you felt you won the first fight, but, you know, the technicality of your arm was raised. You were the winner of that fight. How did that feel?
It was cool, man. You know, I had to try to be effective. He threw me off because the whole time I was training for someone to come forward, and I was going to, you know, look for takedowns in the open, use my jab more. But I had my range for someone coming forward. But this time he's going backwards and trying to get the cage. I don't understand what his game plan was, but, you know, I don't know. I guess it worked a little bit in the second. I guess I don't really know. I lost focus because the second round, having the cage, I saw a fight broke out, and I just lost focus. I could hear the crowd cheering, and a big fight broke out, and I saw everybody standing up, looking to their left. So I like moved my head so I looked to my right, and I couldn't see what was going on, and I just lost focus, man. I don't know what I was thinking.
That's what Dana says. Fight breaks out. Everyone watches.
That's right. Yeah.
Even
yeah,
the fighters.
We could tell something was going on. In fact, one of our listeners, Hal from Chicago, has he made that public? He has some footage, doesn't he?
Yeah, he does.
Yeah. It didn't look as good as what it sounded like, but yeah, I guess there was a few fights in the crowd that night.
Yeah, I think there's like three or something like that, but I know when we fight, it was like one or two because I heard like the commotion, and I was like, man, there's something going on. Mm-hmm. I wanted to see it my damn self, but I couldn't.
All right, so how did it happen that when they started to tell you you were going to fight Ryan Bader at Bellator NYC, you kind of already knew because you started to call him out? Was that something that was already talked about, or you had a feeling? We're wondering why it's not Phil Davis and Ryan Bader, just because they had openly talked about fighting each other, although we're happy for you if that's the matchup for you.
Well, the thing is, like, why else was it going to be there? You know what I'm saying? I saw them do a face-off with Lorenz Larkin and Lima. So I was like, all right. And then that one dude called out the other, the guy from Ireland, the Brazilian from Ireland. And I was like, man. And then when I was in there, he's like, we have somebody here. And I was like, you know, I was like, it's not Phil. I was like, it's Ryan Bader. I was like, where's Bader at? He's like, bring him on out here. Because it only made sense that they didn't have me fight him.
Okay. Goes, what do you have for King Mo?
Mo, so the days at heavyweight, are these days over, or are you still that money weight that would take another fight at heavyweight? Because Rampage just seems so big in there, man, and it seemed like you got in deep and were able, like, you were in perfect position to do the things you wanted to do. It just seemed like at times he was just too big. Are you going to continue to take these type of fights? Well, I know your next one's at 205, but is the door closed on heavyweight, or is it still open?
No, I'll fight whatever. I don't care. The thing is, like, Quentin actually did use proper technique. Instead of keeping his leg straight, he bent his leg. And he, instead of fighting me out in the open, he used the cage as a crutch. So he can lean up against the cage. If I took him down, he used the cage to get back up. If we're out in the open, he wouldn't be able to get back up as easy. But he used the cage, you know, which is smart. He's a vet, you know what I'm saying? But just, I don't know, just he just changed it up on me. I was training for something totally opposite of what I got.
Is there closure between the two of you now? I mean, technically, on paper, you're 1-1, but a lot of people felt you won the first fight. You felt you won the first fight. Do you have that sense of closure?
You know what? It makes a difference to me. If he wants to fight again, I'll fight whoever. You know what I'm saying? Because, you know, that's what I do. But as far as closure, we're 1-1. I wouldn't mind doing a third one. You know what I'm saying? But if we fight, like, you know, hopefully he can fight me at 205. If not, I fight me in the heavyweight. I don't care. You know, it is what it is. You know, I thought for this fight, the aggressor, I try to push the pace more. I didn't want to fight him, like, you know, I didn't want to be out there and, like, you know, in the middle of, like, no man's land where he could land them shots. Because the second round, I was there. I just lost focus. He caught me with, like, 5 good shots, something like that, and a few grazing shots. And then, when I clinched him, he hit me with the hip toss, like, and tried to throw me, you know what I'm saying, which was funny because I didn't even see it coming. I was just like, whatever, you know what I'm saying? And then when that end just popped up, I was like, all right, I get my mind right. And, you know, I went out there in the third round. I was trying to pressure him as much as I could because I knew, like, what I was going to do was the last, like, 3 minutes, I was going to turn it up on him. But what happened was once they broke us apart, he shot on me because he was tired, you know what I'm saying? The pace got to him. He was tired, and after that, I just took over.
There's two conversations I want to ask you about. One was the one with Rampage, as you know, right before they're about to read the cards, and the other one was with Bader in the cage. Can you maybe share what it was you guys were chatting about?
Yeah, with Quentin, you know, I told him, I was like, look, man, you know, when you said you understand, when because he talked about how he didn't, his biggest regret was getting MMA. He explained what he meant. He said, I don't mean not getting MMA. He's like, I mean, like, in MMA, I missed things like. I miss, like, my sister, miss my family. I didn't spend much time with my family. And I was like, look, man, I understand that's real stuff because I ain't seen my mom in a while. I got family that I don't spend enough time with. You know what I'm saying? I got a little brother that's 17 that I haven't seen him play basketball much. And I'm missing out a lot because I'm always training or I always got something booked. And then with Bader, I was like, hey, Bader, I was like, hey, thanks for coming to Bellator, man, because, you know, I can't fight forever. And when it's all said and done, we need people like you and Phil and Lorenz and Lima and the Fab Five and AJ McKee to take Bellator to a whole different level. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, after we fight, it is what it is. But once I'm done, keep on pushing. Keep on doing big things.
Interesting conversations. With the Bader one, I kind of get. With the Quentin one, like, it looked more like, I respect you. We both got in here and fought in front of people. You actually were talking about a story of him that he had told earlier about him missing his family and what MMA had done to his life, right?
Yeah. Cause the thing is, I thought maybe he's coming in a bad mood. And he's like in a bad mood. Said, I regret being in MMA. Once he explained it, I was like, you know what? That makes a lot of sense because I missed a lot of things because of MMA. Mm-hmm. I missed my sister's wedding, missed my brother's wedding. You know, I missed a lot, man. So I was like, you know, it's part of the game, but I understand where it's coming from.
Wow. Weddings? Wow. That is a lot.
Kind of makes you more gracious that he gives us shit the time of day, right, when he's in Vegas?
Yeah. Man, my thoughts were hop on a plane when he said that. You know, like, I get some stuff is important, but I don't think you guys are in camp year-round. But then again, I guess it gets expensive, and maybe that's the commitment you need to be a world-class fighter is to give a lot of stuff up too?
Well, with him, I don't know. With me, I always stay in shape all year round, you know, and I try, if anything pops up, I'm there. I'm ready. You know what I'm saying? Like, over the, I think the past 3 years or something like that, I fought 12 times, if not more.
You know, because...
You know, since, like, last month, like, well, that's... Go ahead.
No, you go ahead. You're the guest.
Okay, when I fought Quentin last, I was like, I had like 8 or 9 fights in between that. So, like, you know, that year I fought Quentin. The year I fought Quentin, I fought once before we fought. So I'm thinking like that was 11 times or 12 times since since I fought. You know what I'm saying? Like that year to now.
By the way, that was an alpha moment for me right there. I told another guy what to do. I said, "No, you go ahead." You see that? And he actually obeyed me.
And I like how you waited.
Yeah.
And just made him speak.
Mo, one last thing. You know, Goz had pointed out that is June 24th in New York too soon? You've been through a lot of camps, a lot of flights. You fought guys out of your weight class, the Crow Cop KO. Is it too soon?
Yeah, I don't know. You know, so the Crow Cop KO, like, I believe it was now. I was stunned and, you know what? He was going to beat me, I think, because he could kick me in the face. So I can't say the bad stoppage because I was stunned. You know what I'm saying? And I saw him come towards me. And I saw the referee jump in me and save me. Mm-hmm. He could kick me and knee me, you know what I'm saying, Japan. But really, I feel good, man. I'm a little sore, but I think a few ice baths, I'll be good. I'll be back in the gym training.
Well, it's scary for us, though, because we're fans of you as well. We've gotten to know you here when you lived in Vegas. And when you say Quentin hit me and I seen 4 Quintons, then we look at each other and go, wow, you know, that's, you know, when you know how it is, successive KOs or whatever. Or sorry, not KOs, but concussions. Maybe time off is the best thing. And then they bring in this other killer and Ryan Bader, and they go, you guys are doing it in less than 3 months. And we're like, wow, all right. I mean, maybe.
Well, Quentin hit me right in my eye. I wasn't really dizzy. He hit me right in my eye. So I was like, man, my eye was like lazy. He got lazy a little bit.
Yeah.
Because he hit me in my eye. So I was like, I had to like rub my eye. And all of a sudden I was like, man, I see four Quintons. And I blink, I start blinking. And I was like, I'm going to go from 4 to 3 to 2 to 1. That's how I was good. Like, you know, like, if I was really hurt, you would see me stumble and like limp or stumble and like, you know, back to my corner. But I walked back to my corner like nothing happened.
I got you. All right. Well, I hope you had a good time out at WrestleMania, and congrats on the win this past weekend. I mean, that's a pretty solid weekend in anybody's book. So I guess we'll be catching up soon.
Quick question. When is When is the gathering again?
May 23rd through the 27th.
Yep.
23rd to 27th, huh?
So 1 month before your fight.
I will make my appearance. I'll be at your arrival.
Damn.
Nice.
This guy keeps his word, man.
Yeah.
You know how I was going to pitch it to him? Say, take a few days off, start your camp, and then what a lot of fighters do when they do these longer camps is they break away. It's like this little breakaway to refresh the body. Mm-hmm. That's what the gathering can be for King Mo. And King Mo doesn't drink, so it's not like he'll be coming here and he'll be, you know.
Yeah, he'll be with Roger,
painting the town. Yeah, exactly.
It's like what most alphas do. He's going to come here and take his spot back. You better.
He's got a trivia card. Yeah,
I'm probably gonna fight from there. I'm gonna be in Connecticut. From Connecticut, I'll fly to Vegas, and then, you know, saying and make sure my team is good for the trivia. Because last time my team was slacking. I had you know, the year before we were champions. Last year, you know, my team was kind of tripping a little bit. This year I'm coming back to reclaim my title as a champion. Trivia champion.
All right, King Mo, we got to go. But thanks for recommitting to us. We can't wait to see you late May. And again, enjoy the fruits of your labor from this past weekend. Congrats on that win.
Thank you.
All right, take care. And that is King Mo. They don't make them like him anymore, man.
Nope.
Solid to get a recommitment from one of the great fighters in mixed martial arts. That's right. The Junkie Gathering is coming up at the end of May. All right. We got to take this break. When we come back, we'll talk to Iaquinta, UFC lightweight. He's got a fight coming up against Diego Sanchez here in a couple weeks. So we'll see where his mindset is after having been off for almost 2 years. We'll be right back after this break.
They were forged from the same ball sack, but act as though they've never met. They are the brothers Garcia, Gorgeous George, and Goes.
Follow King Mo on Twitter, at King Mo FH. Our next guest, Al Iaquinta. You can follow him on Twitter, at Al Iaquinta. Iaquinta is how you spell Iaquinta. He'll be fighting on April 22nd at the Bridgestone Arena in Nashville, Tennessee. His opponent that night will be Diego Sanchez. That's the co-main event too, Cub Swanson versus Artem Lobov. The last time Al Iaquinta fought was in 2015, a win over George Masvidal, and it was April 4, 2015, so it's just over 2 years. We cannot have a world in which Al Iaquinta, one of our favorites, goes 2 years without fighting. Exactly. Talks shit, connects with the fans one way or another. Don't you dare boo him either. But, you know, he's popular through Tough. I think he gives great interviews. He loves boxing. He just needs to be in the sport, at least while he's young and he can do it. He needs to do it. Once the time's up, the time's up. But right now, the time ain't up for him. He's ready to go. He's joining us now. UFC lightweight, Al Iaquinta. What's up, Al?
What's up, guys? Thanks for having me.
Welcome back to MMA Junkie Radio. You're on with Georgia Goes. We also have MMA manager Jason Janae with us. Listen, man, 2 years, don't do that to us again, brother. You need to be in this sport. You're one of the top lightweights out there. You have some key wins. You have a lot of great years ahead of you. You have a wrestling base. You talk shit. We love having you. We love covering you.
I don't talk shit. I talk shit? Really?
Yeah, I think you do. I mean, you're not out there, like, you know, yapping 24-7, but if somebody asks you something about an opponent, yeah, it's not like you say, I'm going to compete against that fine gentleman, and whoever's hand raised, may the better man, you know, it's never like that with you. You usually let us know.
I'm not a dork, that's what it is.
Exactly, yeah. Anyway, I know some of that was injury, and I know some of that was, what do we call it, butting heads with the UFC, or... was it just miscommunication? How would you label the second year?
Who knows? Who cares? I don't know. I'm just ready to fight. April 22nd, Diego Sanchez, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not really thinking about that too much anymore.
What solved it? You ran into, was it the matchmaker, Dana White? What finally clicked where one day all of a sudden, hey, you know, it's on. I'm back.
I don't know. I just felt like fighting again.
Simple as that?
Yeah, it's pretty much it. I saw Sean Shelby. Sean Shelby and the new matchmaker at the Aljo's fight.
Right.
And I don't know. I just kind of felt like fighting right then and there, so I talked about it. Now we're fighting April 22nd against Diego Sanchez. A good fight, right?
Yeah. Excellent. Yeah. But you know me, man. I'm nosy. So one more time, one last thing here, and then we can talk about you versus Diego Sanchez. You did say who cares, but fans care. We kind of care. So let me ask you one last thing. Did this mean that because you got the urge to fight at some point, I guess, were you the one that kind of had to cave in a little bit, or on their front, were they able to make you happy in any way? Because I knew you stood up for your rights, and I definitely respect that too.
I'm going to Nashville for free. That's pretty cool. I train a little bit, get in there and fight, and get a free trip to Nashville, you know?
All right. Diego Sanchez, tell me about that fight. Is this, because of the age difference, is this one of the guys you wound up cheering for, you know, when he was first starting out his career? Like, not a hero or an idol, but just the guy you cheered for, or was he a guy you hated? Like, is this, you know, you relishing the chance to punch him in the face, or... is it a bummer that you have to be?
I always thought the guy was just out of his mind, you know, and he's so crazy that he's so out of his mind that he just doesn't get tired. He just thinks go, go, go. And it's very hard to stop a guy like that. But I think that recently in his fights, I've seen a few things that make me think I can do it, get it done, you know? Mm-hmm.
Al Iaquinta, our guest here on MMA Junkie Radio. He'll be co-headlining UFC Fight Night 108 on April 22nd in Nashville, Tennessee versus Diego Sanchez. Goes, what do you have for Al Iaquinta?
Al, some fighters in mixed martial arts have had some of their greatest moments fighting Diego Sanchez. He's a guy that comes forward. He's a guy that lets his hands go. Is it going to be tough to stick to a game plan with a guy like this? Because you like to bang as well.
Yeah, but I think I know how this fight, I've just, the way I visualize seeing this fight over and over, I don't think, I'm not going to get suckered into. Gilbert Melendez was having a great fight. You know, Miles Jury just got it done. That was it. There was no war. People don't really talk about that fight, do they? Because that was like, you know, it was kind of just, you made it look easy. And it's very possible that, he's had a couple of really hard fights since then. I know it's never over until it's over, because he's as tough as they come. He's got the Lionheart nickname now, which suits him perfectly. But sometimes, if you have a heart, the stronger your heart is, the more you get beat up. But I respect the guy tremendously. I met him. I hung out with him. He's a great, he's fun to hang out with. He's cool. But I looked up to him when I was coming up into the sport. It was definitely, he was the first Ultimate Fighter winner, and he was one of the first guys to, he was the crazy guy out there, just always having crazy fights. He was one of the first guys like that, so it's him and Forrest Griffin. So it's one of those fights where you're like, wow, you look up to someone so long, and then now you're fighting against him. It's pretty cool.
In this time off, would you say you were able to sharpen the skills you had, tighten some screws, or could this possibly even be maybe a rebirth of Al Iaquinta?
Oh, I think, I got, now I'm like really in my prime. I feel like I'm the strongest I've ever been. I think I've gotten better. I've gotten faster. My body's healed up. I feel good, my body feels good. I was fighting very frequently, and you never really feel great. And I think Diego Sanchez has been fighting a lot, and he's had, that takes a toll on you, and it catches up with you real quick. And I think, I don't see it being a good night for him. I've trained really hard, and, I'm going to be on guard all the time because he's always dangerous. But I really feel comfortable going into this fight.
Where do you feel like you fit in the lightweight division at this point, Al, with a win over Diego Sanchez?
I don't know, probably right. I don't know where. It's a good name to have when you beat a guy like Diego Sanchez. That guy's beat everybody. So, he's fought up at 170, he's fought at 85, he's fought at 45, he's fought the best of the best. So when I beat him, I can be like, this guy beat all these guys. I'm right there with everybody in the world,
I can't wait to see it. I can't wait to see it. The return of Al Iaquinta, and it goes down in a few weeks against Diego Sanchez. Says he feels 100% healthy, or as close as you can get to 100% with the nicks and knacks that you pick up during a training camp. But one last question about
Are you talking about?
Yeah.
Oh, no, I actually don't even have any real nicks or anything. I feel good.
Good. All right. As far as
the healthiest I've been, I've been going to this place in Staten Island that you get in the cryo tank. You do all this. They have physical therapists there working on everything, and they do. They really take care of me. So it's helped. I've actually focused on my recovery now. So it's big.
You heard about the announcement with the UFC going to Long Island. Is that basically on your radar?
That would be great. I have no idea. I'm fighting Diego Sanchez, and then we'll figure it out. That would be cool, though, to fight there, wouldn't it?
Hell yeah.
That's where Madison Square Garden would have been cool, but I can count on probably two hands the amount of times that I've gone there. National Coliseum, I've been at 100 times. I used to go there that would be really cool. That would be cool. And it's in the summer. That would be awesome.
Plus, for the first time in your life, you get to fight in Long Island and get paid for it.
Yeah, Wait, what did you get? This would be the first time I actually got paid for it.
Get paid for fighting, yeah. Yeah, we've heard about you on the Nautical Mile. You know, things go down late at night and someone needs to get served up. Iaquinta's there to do it.
Nah, definitely not.
Man, these two guys, when he used to sit here, he was more of a gangster, right? He kind of went soft the last 2 years. I'm just bullshitting now. Hey, man, great to catch up with you. Seriously, happy for your return. Thanks so much for joining us on the show.
And I appreciate it.
Good luck against Diego Sanchez in a few weeks.
Always good talking to you guys. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Take care. We'll see you. All right, folks. That is Iaquinta fighting at UFC Fight Night 108, Swanson versus Loboff. Brian from Boston, make it a quick one, brother, before we're up against the hour. What's on your mind?
I just wanted to say, you know, I made it clear last week how much I'm anticipating this rematch, but I'm also looking at Musasi versus Weidman. And if you take these four fighters, I can't pick which one I want to win because I like each one of them for four separate reasons. So I guess I'm just going to sit back and be fanboy and just hope that both are great fights. Because I don't want to see Weidman lose three in a row, and I love Musashi's skill set, love Cormier's wrestling, and love Rumble's power. So I don't know who to even root for.
Sounds like you're hoping that there's two draws so that nobody loses.
That would
nobody
be good.
Has to lose. Is that what you want?
Why not? Yeah, well, not really, but I hope that's one thing I don't want to happen. I just want good fights. I want all four.
I like all four guys, too. I really do like all four guys. If you're a DC fan, at least you know that if AJ wins, they're only 1-1. As far as Musasi and Weidman, that one's tougher. I don't know if they'll meet up again. They should have met up right now because one guy's coming off two losses. The other guy's on four wins. But that division is so confusing right now with GSP now in the mix. Who knows? Thanks for the call, brother. We got to move on. It's the end of the first hour. Thanks to Iaquinta for his time. Got to thank myself for that, for lining that one. Goes, you lined up the King Mo one. Good job there. We still got a few more interviews coming up in the second hour, and we'll also take your calls, 866-522-2846. Patrick Cote, Daniel Weichel, and this is Jason Janae in studio. We'll be right back.
I'm going to keep on the run. I'm going to have me some fun. It cost me my very last dime.
You're not jumping, Jason. All right. It's the second hour.
Can't handle my jump.
The MMA Junkie Radio Show. Van Halen was the shit back in the day. And if they were to tour, I'd probably go check it out because I'm on that 80s kick, giving them those bands a second chance. They're a little bit before my time, so as a teenager, mom and dad weren't trying to give me any of the extra spending money to go see Van Halen. I didn't have a car. And then they kind of went away from being cool.
I miss those days where you'd have to camp outside of a Ticketmaster or something the night before.
Exactly. All right, it is Stun Gun Monday, and we have a little bit of time before we get to Patrick Cote. We'll join him at 2:15 p.m. Eastern, 11:15 a.m. Pacific. And this is MMA manager Jason Genet from Ingrain Media. He's joining us here for today's show. So before we get to Patrick, let's do some stun gun stories, guys. You lead things off. Jason, if you kind of get the vibe, you know what's going on, and something hits you, go ahead and join. Victoria's going to join us as well. But you're batting lead off, guys.
All right. So my stun gun is going to go towards a good friend of the show, Alton Dunham.
Okay.
Alton Dunham, one of the first trips he had to Las Vegas, George, he brought me a hat and a T-shirt from the University of El Paso. That's where he went. Mm-hmm. That's where he got his bachelor's degree.
UTEP.
He wanted to kind of show a little bit of the culture and share it with me.
Right.
Cool. I still have it in my closet, everything. Then all of a sudden, I go online, and I'm seeing Gonzaga, go. This is a couple years ago.
Right.
And now even more. And I'm wondering what he's doing. Well, he's going to Gonzaga for his master's program. However,
hasn't he already finished that or not yet?
He hasn't finished it yet.
Okay.
He's really claiming that. And I'm okay with that. He's doing his master's there. However, he's doing Gonzaga online. I'm not so sure you have that kind of power to be able to go, fuck yeah, we did it. We took it to those guys. If you've never really even stepped foot on the campus, maybe he has to take a test here and there. But isn't the pride and the love with UTEP, that's where you went to class. You sat down. You were in those walls.
Mm-hmm. Have you been
you went to
El
those
Paso?
Rallies. Yeah.
It's probably easier to love Gonzaga.
So I got a stun gun him from that, man. I don't know. I mean, I would be that guy that would say something like, go Zags. I mean, you know, good team this year, but I don't know if I could really embrace him.
He's leading the charge. He's painting his body and everything.
He's that guy.
You're saying chill out. A foam finger you'll put up with.
Yeah.
But don't paint your face.
Maybe
don't lead the chance.
Your avatar. I'll take that.
Right.
So you don't want a Gonzaga hat sent to you?
Nah.
Yeah.
You're wearing Dodgers.
It'd be like when the Clippers, you know how they've been good the last few years?
Oh, look at this guy.
You know how the Clippers got good the last few years? It'd be like us kind of claiming the Clippers just because they're
I grew up
LA.
In L.A., so
we're
it's
Lakers.
Hard to recognize the Clippers ever being good.
Yeah. And
it just sucks so
trust
long.
Me, the Dodgers were doing well last year, and I wanted to just cheer for them. But, Jesus, the looks I'd get from Goes and my buddy Big Ralph, it's like that was a line drawn in the sand when I went
you
Angels.
You quit us.
So I'm like, all right, you know, but I get what you're saying. Good stun gun story there. Victoria, apparently you have a good one. That's what Goz is telling me. What you got?
So this weekend I went to Atlantic City for a beer fest with my two girlfriends. Mm-hmm. And I booked the room. Online it looked really nice. It looked like a hotel. It was a part of Wyndham Suites. And when we got there, it was like one of those outdoor motel type things. They just, like, change the name, try to make it into a hotel.
Like bungalows or something like that?
So the doors facing the street?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
And I wasn't really a fan of that. It was a little sketchy, grimy, cockroach, motel type.
So they tricked your ass, huh?
But the room was nice inside. I just, you know, you could hear the sirens outside. Wasn't for me. So we go to the beer fest. That was from noon. That was really fun. And then, like, it was like 8 o'clock at night, and I started not to feel well. I wasn't comfortable staying in that hotel, so we decided to go home. I asked my two friends if they're okay with it. They said they didn't care. One wanted to go home. The other one said she didn't care. And then the next night, my friend Melanie texted me with this long message to me and my other friend saying that it's crazy that we left, and, you know, we have another trip coming up in June. We're going to Ocean City. We go every year, and now she's backing out of that. She wants her money back. So I am stun gunning her.
Now, to be fair, part of the fun of these road trips is hanging out. And, like, I guess from her side, she's basically saying, could you two have toughed it out a little bit more, and then that way you guys kind of...
I could have, and I asked her. She said she didn't care, so if she would have said, no, we should stay, I'm going to, you know, be a baby about it tomorrow, I would have sucked it up and stayed.
Gotcha. All right.
I just didn't think it was safe for three girls coming in 2 a.m. in a place like that.
Oh, okay. So it was a little bit of a security thing, too, not just the
cockroaches. Once the girl agrees that there's no problem, you can't have an issue the next morning, right?
Right.
Like, yeah. You know me. I'm the devil's advocate guy, though. So wondering if she just wanted to roll with the punches or not start a fight with her two girlfriends at 2 a.m. But, okay. Well, I think, honestly, if cooler heads prevail, you guys can chat it out. You don't want to give up a tradition. I think it's cool when people do their annual things.
Don't bring her to the next trip. She sounds like a Debbie Downer.
All right. Mine has to do with okay, so trying to – never mind. You go first. You go next.
You know
– you have one?
No, I'm just blessed.
No one cut you off on the 15 on the way here from Santa Barbara?
I won $500 playing Titanic. I mean, I had to surrender my man card because there's loud Titanic music playing around you. But for $500, I've done worse. So.
Uh-huh. So you won $500?
Yeah.
Okay. You're up on this trip.
Yeah, I got no one.
But where's our cut?
Here, it's
That's
not a
sweet.
Commodity from California.
That's sweet.
It's water.
All right. Man, I had one, but now that I think about it, I don't think I want to share it. The hell with it. If I rethink it, because it, you know, when it has to do with names and shit, I don't want to get into it right now. So I laid an egg. I'm sorry. Let me see what else happened this weekend that maybe pissed me off. Ghost pissed me off a little bit yesterday, but we fixed it. We had a problem with. Just labeling, but that little setback was about an hour and a half. But he's a good guy. He does a lot of work for the site and for the show, so I'll leave that one alone. I'm just glad we were able to fix it. But yeah.
Jeez, what happened to leaving names?
Nepotism, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm sorry.
A second ago, he's like, I don't want to hurt anybody's feelings, but this fat fuck over here.
Nah, I just, yeah, I mean,
he
whatever.
He doesn't know how to label.
WrestleMania, did you hear about The Undertaker? Like, that might have been his last match.
Mm-hmm.
Do those guys need to go out with a win or a loss? Do you guys follow pro wrestling enough? People were pissed that maybe he should have went out with a win, and instead he left, I guess, his hat and his duster, I think they call it, you know, the big overcoat jacket, and to signify that may have been his last match. And I'm starting off with you because I know you're not the biggest fan of The Undertaker.
Yeah, we have beef. It's still not settled. I don't know why he left his coat and his gloves in there because he ain't done with me. Mm-hmm. But I think it's kind of unique when you go out on a loss like that in pro wrestling because I think everybody's expecting the win, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm okay with it. He's obviously okay with it. But a big thing about pro wrestling is putting the next guy over. And I think sometimes wrestlers take pride in that.
Mm-hmm.
So that could have been the case.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
I think you see a lot of their struggles right now with these old stars coming back.
They're they don't have really new stars.
Struggling building that new Hulk. You know, there's no one like, oh, you know, the young kids aren't, aside from those beautiful, the women of
that's
wrestling.
That's working for them.
Very, very attractive and fun to watch. But yeah, I mean, on the other side, yeah, absolutely. They just don't seem to be building stars. I like a guy like Riddle. I could totally see him being a wrestling character. Interesting enough. He's crazy enough. Says stupid things on the regular. Likes to do so. Could be interesting.
He should just I've never followed his career, but he should just play the pot angle. Why doesn't he do that? It seems like if you're in the pot nowadays, you just have a legion of fans to begin with. Going back to Cheech and Chong, Joe Rogan, the Diaz brothers, just be the stoner guy. I mean, what's the guy?
Spicoli,
yeah.
Too many kids with WWE, though. I think they wouldn't be happy with that.
Them and their signs and their chants. When someone comes out and they look good, if you don't immediately connect, it's like, you suck, and they just cuss you out of the stadium. It's like, relax, man. Let them do it. Let them do a match first or something. It's like, nah, man, it needs to be edgy from the beginning. You know, it's, let's have a chainsaw match on top of the cage. The only way you can win is by cutting someone's arm off or they fall off the cage, and only then do they embrace you. That's the part where I've never been able to figure out. I figured if they're a good character and they give you a decent match, back them.
He's a character himself, but I think he needs a little pizzazz. Riddle.
Riddle, okay.
Yeah, he kind of reminds me of one of like the Von Erichs. He walks out barefoot. He's just got the plain white trunks. I think he needs some kind of
Von Erichs
gimmick.
That's right. Only one of them did it. I think it was Kevin Von Erich, right?
I don't remember
the guy that's still alive, yeah, the Von Erich family from
I think some
the Greater Dallas area.
It's like MMA. It's very difficult to make it to the show and make it healthy to the show and put on a good show when you make it to the show because their training regimen is very difficult on their body. So they end up more often than not being injured longer than maybe a professional fighter does, because they they're lifting a full-grown man off of us, you know, even though they're all trying to work together and practicing those moves to get them right. There's some danger there.
Like, have you ever just on a Saturday night, you didn't go out with your friends, nothing, and you're just going through the channels. You ever just come
when
across
it blurs?
No, late night lucha libre.
Oh, I thought
these guys aren't even like 6 foot seven, 300 pounds. The blur on TV, select TV. Yeah, no, I'm talking about
first boob.
Lucha libre. You'll watch them, and dude, I don't know if it's the masks, the capes, or just the great moves. It's like actual great entertainment, and but you know, in no way are they doing. You know, are they not? They don't have the Hulk Hogan build, or they don't have the stages and the fireworks and or anything like that. But the crowd connects because, for one, there's just some athleticism.
Yeah.
And I think that's what's missing a little bit from WWE. A lot of it just seems to be like, you know, how big can you get?
Yeah.
How many tattoos do you have? How long is your hair? I don't know. I mean, a certain look. But I really think there's something you can bring trends back. Watch Shawshank Redemption, the movie. Is that what it's called?
Everyone has that haircut now.
Remember those? Well, yeah. Do you remember those real baggy jeans that they wear there?
Yeah.
That kind of brought it back. But my dad told me, he goes, oh, yeah, they did it in the 50s. You know, that's why the movie's based
rolling
like that.
Your jeans.
Same thing. A lot of these trends just come back. Sometimes that's all you have to do is look back in the history books and see. And you might be the old school guy, but it works. All right, let's get a break out of the way. When we come back, we'll talk to Patrick Cote. He's going to be fighting Thiago Alves at UFC 210, which goes down this Saturday. It's Daniel Cormier and Anthony Johnson at the top of the billing. But this is one of the fights on the main event. And it's going to be a good one between two solid welterweights who've been in the sport for a long time. You're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on Sirius XM, Rush 93. We'll be right back in 2.5 minutes. Jason Jenny in the house.
They pat down TSA agents because they don't know where those people have been, and because they can. They are Gorgeous George and Goes, and this is MMA Junkie Radio.
All right, we're back. Patrick Cote will join us pretty soon. Talk to him about that fight he has versus Thiago Alves at UFC 210. It is fight week. We're kind of putting to bed Bellator 175, the fight with Rampage and King Mo. We talked to King Mo today. Up next for King Mo is Ryan Bader. Up next for Rampage Jackson. We don't know, but we're hearing it may be the UFC. We'll see what happens there. And then, you know, WrestleMania went down. A couple titles changed hands, I believe. And The Undertaker may have wrestled his last match. And then, of course, March Madness has Gonzaga University versus the University of North Carolina in the finals tonight. Who do you got, Goz?
I got North Carolina. I think they're better coached. Mm-hmm. And I think their athleticism will get to Gonzaga.
They're tall. Do you see how Oregon gave away the ball? Okay, that's a stun gun story right there. Seriously. A lot of the fundamentals of any sport are muscle memory. And look, in no way did I play any high level, but if I go to the street right now and somebody goes, do you want to play? I'd say, all right. There's just a few things I remember. And one thing is, when the ball's up in the air, you look for the guy that was guarding you, and you block him out. If he's super tall or super athletic, he may still be able to lean over you without getting that foul called on him, the over the back, and maybe tip it. But for the most part, if he was that tall, he probably wouldn't be there in your game. Or maybe you'd be a little bit more aggressive with it or whatever. But, boy, man, that I think it was number 32 on Oregon. Two times he just stood there just waiting for the ball. And the tall North Carolina guy. And they even said it. I mean, like, I actually rewound it for Juliet. I was showing her, look, this is what he should have done. And I even went back a couple plays and a couple guys were doing it. But it was terrible. I'm telling you, that guy is getting railed back on campus right now because that was awful. Even his teammates emphasized it. Block out, because they had literally just gotten the rebound earlier. But he missed free throws, so they fouled him again. And they go, block out, and he still didn't do anything. The other guy, oh, man, it was horrible. But, yeah, North Carolina's tall. They got height, and that might make a difference.
They've got depth, too.
Oh, yeah, definitely. All right, joining us now on the hotline is Patrick Cote, who will be fighting at UFC 210 this Saturday in Buffalo. What's up, Patrick? How you doing?
Hey, how you doing, guys?
Good, my man. Welcome back to MMA Junkie Radio. You're on with George and Goz. We also have MMA manager Jason Janae here with us. Cannot wait for this fight versus you and Thiago Alves, man. You guys have been around the sport for a long time, and it's good to see two veterans get in there and do this thing.
Yeah, you're right. We are two good old veterans. We've been in the sport since so many years. We almost have the same record too, so it's gonna be fun, yeah.
Patrick, tell me if I'm right here on something. I believe fighters come in and they're ballsy and risky and they go after it, right? And then at some point, maybe it's the 10th, 15th, or 20th fight, they settle into more of a tactician. They realize the sport can be dangerous and you know, you think about concussions and weight cuts and blah, blah, blah. And so maybe the fighter becomes more reserved. And then they reach a point after that when they realize, wait a minute, the sport is rather safe, and I'm taking precautions in my training camps and everything, and now I'm just going to go out there and have fun and entertain. So would you say you maybe almost fit what I just said, you know, reckless, tactical, and now you're maybe not reckless, but, you know, risk taker, entertainer here in the latter stages of your career?
No, you're right. I think with the experience, you learn a lot. You know, you have more knowledge about taking care of yourself, about the risk of the sport, and especially in the, you know, the way you train, a lot of things that change, you know, during all those past years. And not just because you're a veteran or something like that, just because of the knowledge of the sport. This is not a new sport anymore. You know, this sport, it's so many people doing the sport, so many trainers, so many nutritionists, so many people involved in that sport, that it's very easy to understand how to prevent, you know, a very serious injury and how to train, you know, smarter.
I also believe that a fighter goes through that stage where after a few fights, if they haven't made enough money, they start to question why they started the sport and what they're doing. But yet, you hit your stride after a certain amount of fights, you put some money away, and then all of a sudden, once again, the sport becomes fun. Well, you've had that type of success. You also have different streams of revenue. So, again, are you not? Is it now because you're more comfortable about your future that you can go out there and just have some fun against some of these other guys just like yourself?
Yeah, you're right. You know, I'm doing that because I want to, not because I need to.
Exactly.
You know, I did prepare my career since three or four years now. And, you know, in that sport, you make a lot of money in a short period of time. And you have to be smart with the money, to place your money in a good place, or just to use those three letters at UFC, that's very, very powerful, that they're going to give you, you know, occasion to do something else and maybe to grow your personality, to grow your business, because you are a little business. You know, we are self-workers, so you have to take care of yourself. So that's the thing. You have to think more about the future than the present, even if the, you know, even if the, it's very important to stay focused about what's going on today. But you know what? This is a tough sport, and you're right. We're not, you know, they want to compare to NFL, NHL, not so those things, but we're not millionaires, you know. But you know, there's a thing that you can do to have a nice retirement after that.
Patrick Cote, our guest here on MMA Junkie Radio. He fights Thiago Alves on Saturday on the UFC 210 pay-per-view. He is on the main card. It's the second fight of the main card. It starts at 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 Pacific. Goes, what do you have for Patrick Cote?
Patrick, both you and Thiago are pressure fighters. You like to put pressure on your opponent, come forward. Something's got to give, though, man. Are you going to be the guy that's going to be willing to sit back and maybe counter a little bit, or will you be that pressure guy against Thiago?
I'm 37 years old, and it's going to be my fight 21 in the UFC. I don't see myself changing my style at that point. I'm going there. I'm going to push forward. And you know, I know I have a better boxing than him. I know I have better power than him. And you know what? I'm going to be a bigger guy. I'm going to have a reach advantage, a size advantage too. So I'm going to bully him. You know, that's the thing. His last fight, he got bullied by the 155 guy. So when he's going to be in front of me and not a big 170, it's going to be a different story. You know, it's going to be exactly the same thing. But, you know, I'll finish him probably, you know, before the fight. I'll finish him in the second. And as soon as he's going to feel the power, he's going to crumble.
This is the fight capital of the world, but it's also the gambling capital of the world. And from my seat here at the Mandalay Bay, I can see the odds. You're a minus 170. You're the favorite. Do you agree with those odds? Are they accurate? Do you feel like they should be even more? Is it a closer fight? How do you feel about that?
You know what? To be honest, I don't care. You know, I've been underdog almost all my career. And when you go there, you know, you can be favorite on millions on paper. But, you know, when the bell rings, it's 50-50. It depends who's more ready or physically, mentally. And, you know, it doesn't affect me at all. You know, the thing is, I know what it's like to be inside the cage. And, you know, if you think about something outside the cage when the fight goes on, it's very bad.
Have you ever bet on a fight, Patrick?
Pardon me?
Have you ever bet on a fight?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I bet on the fight a lot of times. And not on my fight, but it's because it's bad luck. They say that it's bad luck.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, I bet on fights a couple of times, and yeah, that's cool.
I think it adds a lot of excitement to our sport. I know it makes other sport. I know it made the NFL what it is today, the juggernaut that it is. And so I love talking fights. I love talking parlays. So let me ask you something. Who do you like in Musasi and Weidman? Because I know you're a fan of the sport. Oh, and you call the fights, but you're not calling this one because you're participating. So who do you predict in Weidman and Musasi?
You know, I love Weidman. You know, I hope he's going to get the win. You know, I don't think he deserved two losses in a row. You know, he's a former champ, but you never know how the guy's going to react after his first loss of his career. And he looks like he was lost in his last fight, too. So he's like in a, you know, he's like in a moving sand now. So I hope it's gonna be about to get back on the winning track, and you know, to win the fight against Musasi.
What about Anthony Johnson and Daniel Cormier? Who do you like there?
I got Johnson. I think Johnson learned a lot about the last fight against Cormier, and you know what? There's only, you know, I always say that I ain't scared of anybody on my feet. And but there's only one guy I will never share a cage with it, and it's Anthony Johnson. You know, this guy is so powerful. Every time he touches you, it's because it's gonna hurt you for sure. So I think it's this time he's gonna get it.
Can you believe that guy used to be in your division? He used to be a welterweight at one point.
yeah, I didn't make a lot and make wait a lot of time, but yeah, that's crazy that he was a 170 before.
Wow. Well, there you go. I mean, they don't come any tougher than Patrick Cote, and he's saying he wouldn't share the octagon with Anthony Johnson. So a lot of respect there. All right. Well, listen, it is fight week. We'll keep it short. Are a lot of people driving down to Buffalo? Are you driving or flying? What's easier? What's more fun for you?
I'm going to fly. You know, unfortunately, from Montreal to Buffalo, it's very, very short flight, but there's no direct flight. It doesn't exist. So we have to pass by Detroit, and after that, we're going to Buffalo. That's kind of weird, but it's better than driving 8 hours. So we're going to relax in the plane, in the airport. We're going to relax, and we're leaving tomorrow morning. So can't wait to be there. Can't wait to be part of the big big event that, you know, UFC didn't win there since 1995. So, like, 2 decades, the Buffalo waiting for the UFC again. A lot of Canadians going to cross the border to come to watch the fight, and we're going to have a lot of supporters over there. So it's gonna be a fun night.
A lot of Canadians jerseys, a lot of Buffalo Sabres jerseys. That should be fun in the crowd as well. You know, we had you on the show at the time. You were looking for Ellenberger. It didn't come to fruition. Is that still a fight you want to get down the road, or were you just trying to get Ellenberger for Buffalo, and now that you have an opponent, it doesn't matter?
I'm going one fight at a time right now, and it's kind of weird. You know, he's fighting a week or 2 weeks after me against a very, very dangerous guy, Mike Perry. Mm-hmm. And Perry is very powerful. And, you know, I'm not going to be surprised that if Perry knocked him out. Seriously, I think it's, I don't know, man. It's kind of weird, you know. Like you know, we had that story a couple of years ago, and now the fight didn't happen. And now I tried to recreate that story to have a good fight, and now he's fighting another guy a week or two after me. I don't remember, but it's kind of weird from his side. But hey, doesn't matter. Now we're gonna fight Thiago Alves. Anyway, I think this fight against Alves, it's going to be 10 times more entertaining than the fight against Ellenberger. I think for the fans who's going to be there at the event, and the fans going to watch that on TV, this fight is amazing. It's going to be a fun fight, and I'm very, very confident to get back with the win in Montreal.
All right. Well, I agree. It's going to be a great fight, and perhaps if you and Ellenberger win, maybe we can revisit that in a few weeks. But for now, it's you versus Thiago Alves at UFC 210. Patrick Cote, thank you very much for the time, as always.
Thanks, guys.
All right, we'll see you. You can follow Patrick Cote on Twitter at Patrick_Cote. King Mo at King Mo FH. Al Iaquinta at Al Iaquinta. That's at the goes. I'm at MMA Junkie George. Our show's at MMA Junkie Radio. Jason, I was looking. You haven't tweeted in a while from the Ingrain Media account. Is that just something you're over?
Well, Twitter isn't what it used to be from a brand perspective, but the reality is that, yeah, we spend more time working for other people's Twitter accounts and social media accounts, and it's really not fun to do for yourself. Mm-hmm. So we just rather put in the hard work for other people.
Jason's managed a lot of fighters over the years, Shane Carwin, Ryan Bader, CB Dolloway, currently works with the Camozzi brothers. Has that been a fun experience for you, MMA? You know, a lot of times a manager, you'll hear about them, and then you don't hear about them for a while, and then you run into them, and you're like, some of them don't have positive things to say, others use that platform to, you know, stay within mixed martial arts and do other things. But where do you sit with your time as a manager and the sport as a whole?
Yeah, you know, I entered management for a different reason. I was a marketing guy that was struggling with getting my message on TV because people were fast-forwarding commercials, but we weren't really discussing it as marketing execs at the time. And so I was actually a fan of the sport, and I could see the captivated audience in the content, watching the content.
Right.
And so I felt like it was really an important place that we could be with a brand, take it in the content that your target demographic is watching. But I did it different. You know, we went head to toe. We were the very first company to ever put a fighter head to toe single brand. So like when
Which
Varner,
one was that?
I think UFC 63 or 68, Varner versus Jason Gillum was the very first head to toe. It was a company called Anonymous Email, which would probably be a great company in today's era. But, you know, yeah.
You don't have any Russian friends, do you?
No, not that I know of.
Oh, okay.
But, you know, what happened was, like, as Varner is walking out and his corner and everyone else is wearing head-to-toe one brand, you know, the fighters are told before the fight, don't mention your sponsors, right? You're not allowed to mention them. So here's Joe Rogan on the mic, like, anonymous email. What the F is that?
He said that?
Yeah, okay. So he literally said it and saw it. It was so reactionary.
Is that in Columbus?
Yeah.
Okay.
And so I remember, you know, for me, that was like the very first time that I'm like, okay, so this is it. I'm right. But I was so far ahead of the curve, like talking to brands and big brands. And I'm like, look, we can get you into the content and you can be a part of a fight team and all. It was a lot harder, you know, but we did get companies like Soyo, who's a television company making televisions and monitors for like Honeywell and Walmart. They did a fight team. MTX fight team was pretty successful. Bader, Benson Henderson. I mean, we took Ben Henderson from Jamie Varner's sparring partners. And I remember the Lally's like, that guy will never be anything. I'm like, ah, he's pretty hungry, you know? Yeah. And he's like, oh, no, we just
did
use
they
him.
Publicly say that, or did you share?
They just shared it with me. There's like, you know, they were just saying, like, we use him for Jamie to beat up. And I'm just like, I think that he actually has a lot of the fundamentals of, like, just willing to grind it out in the gym and put the hard work in. And so we just built a good career trajectory for the guy, but also, like, putting a good financial foundation in place, not just from when they end fighting, which, as Cote said, is super important, but when you start fighting. There's no reason to start fighting and be an 0-0 guy. You know, that's where I actually met Chris Camozzi. We managed against him. We actually picked him to fight Jesse Forbes, MFC, probably fight of the year that year. And I just remember sitting at home watching it and thinking to myself that whoever that kid is, and he's making $1,000 to fight Forbes, and we've paid Forbes, like, we paid his travel, we paid for the corners. So, like, we're sending two corners to an MFC fight, paid for hotel, food, per diem. Everything's covered, including the fighter, on a salary. And it's just like, no way that Jesse Forbes is going to lose this fight. This was, like, to get him back into the UFC. And I just remember Chris Camozzi spinning him around. Like, it was like Rocky, a televised fight. They were just throwing blows. And when the end of the fight and the arm snapped on Camozzi, you could see, like, hesitation. Like, do I even tap out because there's only 30 seconds left in this fight and I just beat this UFC vet? Like, that grittiness and that griminess, I was just immediately drawn to, like, I need to work with that guy too, you know? Like, and then Jesse's such a good guy. Like, he brings Camozzi back to Arizona, like they're having a sleepover, you know, healing, talking about, like, their 80 stitches combined and having a good, like, post-fight week. And it was good to meet him. And ever since then, like, we've managed him for almost 20 fights now, and 18 of them been in the UFC. Got him signed, like, 3 times. So it's good to work for people like that, because – and that's what we do as managers. We work for the fighter. It's really a great boss when your boss appreciates your work, you know. And Chris is really good about appreciating the job that gets done for him. Mm-hmm. We help his other business, too. We helped him buy Performance MMA, the online fight store. So we help him with that. We help him market that business and run ads for him on social media, run ads for him on Google, et cetera. So we do more for him than just arranging fights, fight contracts, you know, sponsorships, for sure.
Is it difficult to keep up with marketing? Marketing seems like it evolves so quickly.
Yes. Yeah, but, I mean, that's what I live, you know. So, like, you guys live MMA. I live kind of, like, marketing trends. I'm looking at what's working on Instagram today. I'm studying algorithms, and I, you know, sometimes I have to just talk to myself about algorithms because people don't care. But, like, every day there's algorithm changes, and sometimes it'll take 90 days to see what Google just did. And then you've got to go rework or rethink the way that you were approaching the market from a digital standpoint. But digital marketing is, every day it's something different. Like, just sitting here talking about, oh, well, Twitter's not really that important to a brand. A year ago, that would have been insane to say. You know what I mean? But it isn't as compelling because, as you can see with just Donald Trump, it's difficult to convey a message in 140 characters. And then if you look at the leaders like Facebook and Instagram, what are they doing? Stories, right? And why are they doing stories? Because people want to watch a story. And so you can't do a story in 140 characters.
Is there a trend amongst marketing that you could say you called where you could look at and go, I called that one. I knew that was going to blow up.
I think so, but I mean, it's hard to say that you were, you know, if you're always right in marketing, then you're doing something wrong because you learn from mistakes in marketing. You're like, that didn't work. And so you take and analyze data and you're processing data and bits of information and success, and you're looking for return on investments that are scalable, and it's really akin to gold mining. You just put a bunch of holes in the ground, and then you see, oh, okay, there's a little bit of gold there. I'm going to dig a little further and see if I can expand it. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you have to be willing to accept failure as not the end game.
For a future show, when we have a little bit of downtime, George, I'd like to bring up that topic of a fighter that you kind of said he ain't going nowhere, and he just blew up on your in your face.
Because of their skills or their marketing?
Just anything. Now, I'll throw mine out because we're actually good friends with this guy.
Who?
Remember when Gil Martinez introduced us to Michael Chandler? Mm-hmm. The first thing that went through my head was, that frat boy? Get real.
Really?
Yeah. And then he blew up. And that was like a year later. He was already like the champion or something like that.
But you know what's crazy about guys like that is that somebody had told them or they believed that I'm going to be a champion, but never put the other foundations in place to benefit from championism. So when you're going to, if you're going to be the guy to go get the guy, then have a plan for every step of the way. Don't be the guy that's on the undercard making no money. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that someone on Bloody Elbow rated, I don't know if we're allowed to say that URL, so don't go.
Yeah.
But they said that Chris Camozzi's the middle of the middle of the middle. I like to call him that now. But middle of the middle of the middle client. Well, my middle of the middle client still gets paid monthly salary by brands.
Nice.
I don't think the champion's making that much money, and he made mid six figures last year. So if I can do that with the middle of the middle,
and Camozzi's on some island. I don't know if he's back, but
Turks and Caicos.
He was sending me his pictures on the beach. The water was clear. It looked like he was having a blast.
Yeah, he doesn't ever invite me to those trips. I don't look as good in a bathing suit as his wife, which could be the problem. Mm. But I told him I'm not afraid to wear a two-piece. I've got my summer bod going.
Guys, I'll answer your question, and then we got to get to our break here. We'll finish up with Daniel Weichel. He's fighting for Bellator. Rafael Dos Anjos, first time I saw him fight, I thought another jiu-jitsu guy who will probably go 5-5, maybe 6-4, and maybe he'll get caught on the end of a three-fight losing streak, and then he gets cut, right? So not from the marketing purposes. He did learn English, and I would say he's on the upper tier of at least he can communicate, which is good for him. But he's just not marketable because he just doesn't have it. But, man, his skills, oh, wow, he became something else. And also, even thinking about last week when we were talking about the proposed third fight between Overeem and Werdum, I remember there was a point where I just thought, Werdum, bro, if somebody's not going in your guard, you're just done. And he became a really, really great striker. Both of them under the tutelage of Rafael Cordero. Werdum a little bit more marketable. RDA, not really. He's got to basically just win fights and wear a belt. If he ever wants to be,
I spoke to Ed a few times about like marketing some of his guys for him, just like doing the marketing standpoint, letting him do his management side. And I would just say that Anderson's like one of the biggest missed opportunities. And it's hard to say that because you're like, oh, well, he had Nike Brazil and he had all these other brands. But had he learned English, right? And had he not had a post-fight commentator and people really got to know that guy, like really got into his life, he might be the greatest fighter. I mean, he is talent-wise the greatest, one of the greatest fighters we've ever seen. But his personality is very people like him. People want to like him. And he could be in the movies. He could be a Brazilian superstar. Mm-hmm. But it'll probably end up being some Brazilian bull rider that gets that, you know, gets that realm off the PRCA versus, you know, the UFC. But I feel like he missed an opportunity for everything he got is because he earned it as a fighter, but we never saw what he earned or deserved as a person.
You're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on SiriusXM Rush 93. We're going to take our last break. When we come back, we'll be talking to Daniel Weichel, one of the top fighters over there at Bellator. Look at his record. He's really beaten a lot of good fighters, and he'll be fighting soon. So we'll talk about that when we come back. We'll be right back after this break, and this is Jason Janae in-house with us today.
They're so fat, they gave Dracula diabetes. Here are your hosts, Gorgeous George and Goes.
I haven't heard that one in a long time.
About Dracula?
Yeah.
Yeah. Neither have I. I haven't.
Is it type 1 or type 2?
I think we gave him type 2.
So he'll be okay?
Sounds like something he could probably get through it.
All right. We're waiting the call. Oh, look. Speaking of Rafael Dos Anjos meets Tarek Safadin at UFC Fight Night 111 in Singapore. We were just talking about that name. It's a good fight for him, I think, to test the welterweight waters.
Tarek's pretty good.
Somebody had been calling him out RDA lately. Who was it? Colby? Colby Covington, right?
Yeah.
He's pretty creative with the social media. Yeah. He had a I will fight for food or I will fight for something
you
sign.
You mess with Colby, you're messing with Masvidal, too, because those two got each other's back.
Mm-hmm. You sure do. Lyman Good. He was suspended for 6 months for anti-doping infraction, but he can return later this month, so there's already that time served. So there's that going on. Also, the UFC 210, their countdown came out yesterday, so that episode is available. The full episode's available on the front page of MMA Junkie if you want to get familiar. More familiar,
like
I should say, with Cormier and Anthony Johnson.
Yeah, you guys like that era? I'm responsible for it.
I mean, so. I think it had to happen.
You're responsible for USADA?
I am.
Tell me how that happened.
Well, you know, when Carwin was facing, what's his name? Talks a lot around here. He lives here.
Roy Nelson.
that was Roy's shtick, you know, like he wanted the that Balco guy to do the testing, and they
Victor
were sponsoring Conte? Roy and everything. And I'm like, well, there was some good things that Roy was saying about how you could clean up the sport, and maybe Shane had a responsibility to do a little more than the average person. So we reached out, and we reached out to USADA, and we started to talk about how do we enter Shane into a testing pool for a fight like that. And, of course, they needed to speak with Zuffa, and they needed to. So we put the powers that be together. We actually had a cost sheet for just Shane. It was pretty expensive, and in the line of the numbers that you're seeing talked about online, the whereabouts, et cetera. So a lot of what became the new USADA process just started with Shane wanting to prove that he was a clean fighter and going and finding an independent organization that wasn't working with Victor Conte. You know, for lack of a better word, just felt like Conte was corrupt.
Well, I guess I felt like the sport needed it.
Yeah.
To answer your question about USADA. Granted, I see a suspension on stuff where you're just wondering, well, I'm glad that some stuff is getting reduced because 2 years, I have to believe that maybe 5% of the 100% of mistakes are probably just that, mistakes. I don't think an attempt to cheat,
right.
You know. But the problem is you got that hovering over you. That's what it looks like. All right, looks like we have to go with Daniel Weichel, right? He's ready to go?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Daniel Weichel,
yes.
we'll revisit that in just a second, Jason. We have to do a little bit of OT, ask Victoria, she's right with that. Daniel Weichel is fighting at an upcoming Bellator card, and it's John Teixeira at Bellator 177, headlined by Eduardo Dantas and Leandro Higo. It goes down on April 14th in Budapest, Hungary. Daniel Weichel, how you doing?
Thank you. I'm doing good. It's a pleasure to be on your show.
Well, thank you very much. You're on with George and Goes. We also have MMA manager Jason Genet here with us. Boy, I'll tell you what, man. You know, you probably don't want to hear this, but that fight with Frady, you had him. You would have one of the most incredible Bellator careers. You already have a great Bellator career, but it really would be up there as one of the most incredible ones out there for anybody that's been with the company for as long as you have, which I think you're now entering your ninth fight.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. And I'm going to make it 8-1.
Yeah. Well, you know, a lot of people, like I say, they may not have heard of you, but you've had some key fights against some key moments and some good wins. Well, you know, we follow Desmond Green, Pat Curran. We know these guys. So I've been promoting you as one of the top featherweights out there. So anyway, I can't wait to see you back in the mix against John Teixeira. And you know, this one's happening in Europe, and I like that Bellator's kind of spreading their wings out towards your neck of the woods.
Absolutely. I love it that they're coming to Europe more often. So for me, the traveling is a lot more easier,
especially with the weight cut, and also I can bring some fans and friends to the venue. It's awesome.
Mm-hmm. How popular is Bellator in Europe?
It's growing. I think in Europe, it's kind of, it depends on the country. Like in England, it's MMA and Bellator is pretty big. And of course, in Russia, MMA is big. Also Bellator, because it's on regular base on TV. So this helps a lot to make the sport and the promotion grow. So I hope we get Bellator to see on TV in Germany soon. So it will help a lot to make MMA and Bellator more popular here in Germany.
Mm-hmm. Daniel Weichel, our guest here on MMA Junkie Radio. He fights at Bellator 177 on April 14th. Goes, what do you have for Daniel?
Well, Daniel, that was kind of what I wanted to ask you, was how close are they to potentially maybe having a card in Germany? Because they've spread their wings so much out there in Europe, and it seems like everywhere they go, they pack the house.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I would love to see Bellator here in Germany and to be a representative for the sport and for the brand Bellator. So I'm open for that. And yeah, every time I see them, I say, hey, we have to do a show here in Frankfurt or in Germany, anywhere, any place in Germany. I mean, people are really getting interested in MMA, and it's really growing. I get so many people ask me about the sport and how everything is growing. So it's really growing, and I think it's a potential market also here in Germany.
Where would you say is that hot spot in Germany where the card should, in your opinion, be?
Of course, one of the main cities like Berlin or Frankfurt, also Hamburg would be a great city. So these are would be my favorites. Of course, Frankfurt would be my number one choice.
Three straight victories. Do you know where a victory here would put you in the title hunt?
Sorry?
With three straight victories, a victory here, where do you think that would put you in the title picture?
I thought even after the win against Sanchez, that would be I am the number one contender. When I beat Teixeira, I'm still the number one contender. So, but right now, I'm focusing on Teixeira, on nothing else, and I'm going to make 2017 my year.
Folks, let me tell you something, man. This is a good fighter, Daniel Weichel. I've seen him in a lot of fights, and I have a lot to do with the rankings on USA Today Sports and MMA Junkie. So I've seen you compete against a lot of these guys. And I can definitely say you're one of the top guys out there in any promotion. So I'm glad we were able to talk to you. I'm glad you know and speak English very well. And I must say, if Bellator ever goes to Germany, just don't go to Leipzig. Because Goz and I were there one time, and it was World Cup soccer. It was Spain against Ukraine. And nobody in the city could point us in any direction. It's like they didn't like athletics of any kind, right, Goz?
Yeah, it was kind of weird.
Yeah, so I hope it is in Frankfurt or Cologne or Hamburg, like you said, or even Berlin. They love their sports there. But anyway.
Yeah. Of course, definitely. And you're very welcome to step by at MMA Spirit. You are welcome at any time.
Oh, awesome.
Just contact me, and I will give you a tune.
Thank you very much. Thanks for doing the show. We appreciate it. And good luck at Bellator 177 against John Teixeira.
Appreciate it.
Okay, we'll see you.
Thank you.
See ya. Thank you to CJ, Dan, Danny for setting that one up at Daniel Weichel. Goz, what are you doing? A little bit of OT?
She says she's okay with it.
She's okay. So we're going to just do a soft ending here. Thanks to all our guests, Ally Iaquinta, King Mo, Patrick Cote, and Daniel Weichel. This is Jason Janay, MMA manager in studio with us. We just got a couple more questions, so we're going to do a soft ending here, and we'll be right back in about 20 seconds. 40 more. I wouldn't sleep a minute away.
Oh, there's blackjack and poker and
okay. All right, this is a little bit of overtime. Just wanted to finish up the USADA talk because
sure.
I thought it was very interesting. Yeah. You brought them together.
Yep.
And eventually, how long was it from the time when you made this intro to when they made the announcement and they got things going?
It was probably about a year.
Oh, okay.
It took about a year, I think. We'd have to check the dates. But yeah, And they were pretty open to doing just a single athlete, but they really felt like for their system to work, for it to be effective, It needed to be all athletes. For us, it's like it comes down to, like, USADA works off of a disclosure issue. And really, if you look at the heart of probably Mark Hunt's lawsuit, that's really what we're talking about here, right? Is like, Mark's not saying he doesn't want to fight a juicer. He's just saying he has a right to know. You know what I mean? He has a right to know that he's entering into a contract with someone who is chemically enhanced or not chemically enhanced. And if the premise of the contract is they're not chemically enhanced, then you breached your contract with him because you brought something unknowing and you possibly gave him the opportunity to be enhanced by making waivers, exceptions that you might not have made for other people. And I think that's really what USADA was all about when we were talking to him, is like, for it to work, it needs to be consistent across the board. Everybody under the same system, whereabouts testing. I mean, I had two emails today from them just about whereabouts on certain athletes of mine. So they're very serious about it, and there's a reason that it's super expensive to do. But at the other end of it, I always felt like we did a terrible job as a sport of talking about the precautions, right? We let people like McCain run the narrative about what our sport was, when in reality we tested more athletes on professional cards than any other professional sports in the history of professional sports. We were more proactive before USADA era than any NFL, Major League Baseball, you know, and that's looking at a lot of different ways of testing, including like even Nevada State Athletic Commission's random testings, you know, going above and
I
beyond.
I think that was one of the keys. Because, you know, knowing when the test was coming,
sure,
only urine, not blood, I mean, right, it wasn't like it was the most stringent. Yes. But I'll tell you what, I was there at the Red Rock when they had the meeting with Nowitzki and Lorenzo, yes, and Dana. And Dana had this look like, oh, man, I'm not too sure about this era, you know.
Sure.
And I knew that it was going to cost them a lot. Rumors are like $6 or $7 million a year, I think is what it costs. But in the end, boy, that, I mean, a lot of credibility for the UFC, because now it is the most enhanced testing of any promotion, sure, of any sport out there. And I think it has done a cleanup process. And you know what? Long term, a lot of these athletes, they may not like it now, but I think it'll be beneficial to their health too.
Say what you will about Victor Conte, all the bad that he did, what he did do good is tell people that this is what you need to do to fix a test. However, what we need to realize with doping is that USADA is not the answer, okay? It's a step in the right direction for answers. But if you look at cycling, like, cycling has worked doping out of the sport at the highest level, but now they're dealing with mechanical doping, which means they're moving to doping the bike versus the cyclist. So you can test the cyclist, and you can test them all the time, and you'll be able to catch them most of the time. But who's testing the bikes? So a cheater will always cheat and find a way to cheat. So we have to continue to evolve our system. So once something's defined, that's when a cheater's like, oh, well, that's the definition of that. I'm going to go over here into the gray area, or start finding supplements that people aren't talking about or aren't on the list, right?
Right.
Because USADA is not, and WADA is not all-encompassing. They're also learning and evolving as new drugs. You don't really have to look any farther than China to look at the synthetic, like, cannabis and synthetic pills that they put out. By the time our DEA says that's an illegal drug structure, they've restructured the drug, put a different label on it, and have it on the same shelves legally. So that's going to be the nutraceutical market. That's going to be the supplement market. It's always going to be finding the competitive edge. And the people that are running the promotions, the organizations, they need to stay ahead. They need to stay with USADA, WADA, and they need to find the best mechanisms for keeping it safe. Or you look at the bodybuilding model, right? And bodybuilding said, we know that people enhance. So here's an enhanced competition. Here's a natural competition. We're going to do both. Let the fans decide what they like better, right? And you can pick which is fine. You can be a national champion unenhanced, or you can be enhanced. Mm-hmm. And they're okay with that. And that's okay, because you know when you're in the enhanced, if you're not taking those chemicals, you're going to be at a big disadvantage in that contest where you might win the unenhanced contest. So I'm not a bodybuilding guy, as you can tell, but, you know, I'm just saying.
Neither am I, in case anyone's wondering.
That they've worked around what the cheating scenario is, and you don't have to look any farther than professional cycling to realize that there's no anti-doping situation that will fix every sport. The more money you make, the more opportunity there will be to cheat, the more value in cheating as the stakes get higher.
If you ain't cheating, you ain't trying.
That's possibly true.
Yeah. There's also another one. The scum always rises to the top of the water.
Yeah, but we'll have to knock that off before we drink it. So.
Thanks for doing the show, Jason.
Yes, thanks for having me.
And we'll be back tomorrow, folks, with another edition of MMA Junkie Radio. Coming your way tomorrow will be Kenny Florian, Aljamain Sterling, and a few other names that I just can't lock in yet. One rhymes with Keith. I'll put it to you that way. Maybe even an in-studio appearance. Anyway, for Victoria, Engos, and Jason, I'm George. Have a nice day. Thanks for listening, and go out there and be champions.